Welcome, everyone. I don't know how many of you guys have been here before. My name is Libby Pratt, and I'm the director here at Baxter Street at the Camera Club of New York. And our mission is to support emerging lens-based photographers, or lens-based artists. Usually that means photographers. So to that end, we have a lot of different programming, and I'll just go through really briefly what we do. If you want to get involved, get in touch with me afterwards. We have a residency program. This show is part of our residency program, so if you get the residency, then you have a show the following year, and 4 artists are chosen each year. We have a conversation series, which this is a part of. We have a guest curated exhibition program where emerging curators can apply with a show, and if they're chosen, then they have a show here. And we get a lot of support from NISCA, the Department of Cultural Affairs, so that we can support our artists to make the work for the shows. There's a lot of great programming. We also have a membership if you want to print in a darkroom or you want to scan negatives. Get in touch with me afterwards to learn more, or take a postcard. So, and we do other things too, but I'm kind of blanking on what the other things are that we do. So today's talk, I had actually originally thought of doing this during the Lunar New Year, because we have been in Chinatown now for almost two and a half years, and I've been wanting to do something that's really related to the neighborhood, and I thought that this idea of home, place, was a really perfect sort of thing that we could do during the Lunar New Year, which is all about celebrating with your family, and you know, you go to different people's homes and they have food out for you. You know, it depends on which country you live in, but it is very much about family and home and community. So that didn't happen because of scheduling reasons, so we're doing it today, and which is also Passover, and so we thought, you know, maybe that could tie in somehow. That was actually an accident, it wasn't Passover, but that just happened as well. So maybe I will briefly read the bios of the people who are going to be presenting their work, and then we'll go through. So Jessie's going to go first. Jessie Chun is a Brooklyn-based interdisciplinary artist from Seoul, Hong Kong, New York, and Toronto. Select venues of exhibitions and fellowships include the Bronx Museum of the Arts, Spencer Brownstone Gallery, Fridman Gallery, Julie Saul Gallery, BRIC, Lehman College Art Center, CICA Museum, and the Incheon International Women Artists Biennial in Seoul, and Space Debris Art in Istanbul. She currently teaches at the Free Learning Experiment, the Bruce High Quality Foundation University. Chun's work has been reviewed in Art Forum, The Wall Street Journal, The Korea Times, Asia Literary Review, Hyperallergic, Vice, and Art 21. Next, Lewis. Lewis go next. Lewis actually has a show up at Pearl River Mart right now, which is on view until the 30th of April. And it's really close to here, but it'll be closed. It's closed now. But it's on Broadway, just south of Canal, and you go in and there is an abundance of amazing goods to buy, and you can go up and to the back and see the work, some of which you'll see tonight. Lewis Chan is a Chinese-American photographer known for his series titled My Home, which he'll be presenting tonight. My Home is an ongoing series that Lewis Chan began in 2011 as a way of exploring the Chinese immigrant experience and lifestyle in New York City. These large-scale prints serve as a contemporary marker for Chinese Americans to reflect on the hopes, dreams, and sacrifices made for them by older generations in order for their children to have a chance of a better life in America. And last but not least, we have Motohiro Takeda, who actually was one of our residents here at the Camera Club of New York when it was in our old space in, I think, 2011 or 13? A few years ago. But he also is a member and he prints at the darkroom, so we get to see each other a lot. Moto was born in 1982 in Shizuoka, Japan, and moved to New York City at the age of 21, where he obtained his BFA from Parsons, the New School of Design. His work has been exhibited in group exhibitions at the Houston Center for Photography, Houston, Texas, Daniel Cooney Fine Art, the New York Photo Festival, both in NYC and the New York Photo Festival, and at venues across Spain. His solo exhibition of River was presented at Mapamundistas in 2010 in Pamplona, Spain. Takeda was the recipient of the Tierney Fellowship Grant in 2008, and his work has appeared in PDN Magazine and Conveyor Magazine, among other publications. I think you should add that you're a resident here to your
mind. Well, I think I added everything. I mean, you and it.
Maybe that happened. We'll talk about that. So, Jensi's going to go first, and then Lewis, and then sure. Morten. I'm going to get the lights.
Hi, my name is Jensi Chan. I'm a visual artist working primarily, actually no, I don't really have a specific medium anymore, so I work conceptually. My ideas are, I guess, my primary concern. And I'm going to talk about the series called On Paper. And I guess my practice at large is, you know, really engages with these elements of language, context, and cultural memory to investigate the conditions of belonging. So, as my bio probably stated, I'm from multiple countries and I've lived in, you know, Seoul, Hong Kong, New York, Toronto, and so immigration has always been a big part of my life and kind of, I guess, the experience of being at the border, I mean, now it's like a whole new, you know, heightened experience of God knows what, but I think throughout my life I always struggled with how much weight these paperworks carry and, you know, just how this is the only thing that I have to prove my validation of, you know, who I am and, you know, the fact that, you know, this is what they use to ultimately decide if you qualify to be, you know, a part of a place. So in this body of work, I actually redact immigration documents and passports. And the passports are largely from my friend's archives because I only have one passport. But the immigration documents are largely from my own archive, from multiple countries that I've lived in, and also from my family and my in-laws as well, because they're also immigrants. So in this body of work, it's kind of like fragmented into three chapters, but the first chapter is the landscapes. And in the landscapes, I basically used, in all of this work actually, I used the scanner as a camera. And I scanned the background details of passports and kind of re-photograph and I guess play with the composition and things like that and basically leave out all the national markers and the traveler's data and kind of reframe and recontextualize them into these large-scale landscapes of ubiquitous lands. And this one is like 65 inches wide, so they're actually really large scale. So in person, it kind of has this experience of confronting like an actual landscape almost. But also the pixelation, you know, it's obviously the watermarks. And I thought it was really fascinating how, you know, obviously they have watermarks to prevent identity theft. But at the same time, I mean, when you blow them up that big, it just kind of almost looks decorative. And, well, I don't like that word, but, you know, it like looks really aestheticized. And people actually have come up to me, they're like, is this like Japanese silkscreen or something? And I'm like, no. But, and this is actually the American, yeah, it's from the American passport, which I think is really funny because everyone thought this was Japanese. And I think I was also really interested in kind of playing with that, which is, yeah, you can see the scale. But yeah, I was also kind of interested in playing with these different formats and shapes of like landscapes. You know, I think like Eastern landscape tends to have that kind of, you know, panorama. And yeah, so I was really interested in also playing with transcultural aesthetics. And they're all from different countries and they're manipulated. I retouch them heavily to get rid of all the, because you see all the dust and things like that. So also I kind of alternate, or I guess I manipulate some of the colors as well and re-photograph. And occasionally, like this one is actually the full page of that passport page. So, I mean, most of them are really heavily manipulated, but like once in a while, I kind of kept it as it was. This one is actually, it was two pages, but you know, I retouched all the staples out in the middle. So I had a solo show this show, solo show this work last year, and on one wall it was all the landscapes, and the other wall they had had all the immigration documents and abstractions, which I'll now talk about. The installation on the bottom, these pieces are called blueprints. And so that's the digital mock-up of the installation, and this is kind of a close-up of one of them. But basically in this work, I deleted all the text from the immigration documents, and I layered them, I printed them on actual blueprint vellum paper, and then physically layered them. So they kind of mimic this, almost like this visual arrangement that looks like a blueprint, and also kind of played with the color. How they look framed. And I was also interested in kind of playing with the literal frameworks in which we're, you know, identified and defined and validated, and kind of playing with this idea of home and, you know, these blueprints kind of alluding to this architectural plan for a future or potential of a future or place. And these are the other works on the same wall. And these are called forms. And in this work, I abstract and selectively delete text on immigration documents and turn them into concrete poetry. So they were also in different languages. Like some were, like there was one in Korean, one in Chinese, one in French, one in English and French. So this is funny because actually when I show this, the gallery owner is white, but the gallerist is Korean American. And we were joking. I said I really want like one Korean text piece in it, and we were joking about how nobody's gonna understand it. And then the first person that walked in was a gallery artist who's this white male painter, and he immediately read that out loud to me, and he's like, "But what does that mean?" I'm like, "Wait, you read Korean?" And he's like, "Yeah." I'm like, "Why?" He's like, "Oh, my wife is Korean," and I was like, "Whoa." So it was just funny because he immediately, like, the first white guy that walked in read it to me. But that actually says before change, blank piece of paper. And also I did these kind of, I guess, weird paper landscapes with the stack of immigration documents. I'll read you some of the poems I've made. This says translator, 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 or translator. This says blue, vert, gray, noir, brown, lose it. And it's, it's obviously from like an eye color identification thing, but I was also interested in playing with it visually and kind of turning it into this strange poem about, you know, color and race. And this poem, it says mother, father, all sons and daughters, regardless of age or place. After the show, I had another show of just the text works, and it was published into a book by Brooklyn Press. And so it's all the just all the text pieces, the concrete poems, and I made it so that that's the front cover. I mean, actually, there's no front or back. That each, both sides are, I don't want to say reversible, but both sides are, whichever side you open, it reads immediately that way. So in the middle of the book, there's like a two-page spread with all the dots and commas, and you basically have to like reorient yourself. So I was kind of interested in having it so that the narrative can start whichever way you enter. So it's not like a linear, it's not like a one-way thing, but it could be open-ended in both ways, I guess. So yeah, that's the book, and that's pretty much it for that.
Thank you.
So I just want to give a little bit of background to myself before I get into the work. So I was born in New York. I lived there all my life. And I actually grew up on 14th Street between Avenue B and C. And grew up in what we call NYCHA, New York Housing Authority, or some people call it Projects. So all my life I lived there. I moved out when I was about 24, 23. And went to public school all my life, downtown area, Lower East Side area, high school, also nearby. And I basically went to CUNY, so I never left the city, basically. I'm a New York born and raised. So during the time of, so Campos Plaza is the name of the development. And as you can see, this is, it used to be a lot of crime, a lot of drugs, a lot of, you know, negative things, but there are also a lot of great people in the community with a lot of artists and, you know, people struggling and hardworking immigrants and working families. So I got to see that growing up. And this is just a post in October 2014. At this point, things gotten a lot better. When I say better, I mean, obviously there's less crime, but the neighborhood has been sanitized by Mayor Giuliani. And I use sanitize as a negative term, not a positive term. So, for example, someone posts like, you know, many complaints about people throwing diapers, glass, feminine products out the windows, as well as your guests been breaking the lobby door, pissing in the elevator and stairways, or garbage left in the hallway, elevators in the front of the building. Garbage should be placed in an incinerator or in a dumpster located outside, so on and so forth. It creates a rat problem. Campos Plaza and a lot of above contributes to the problem, so on and so forth. So this is just a neighbor posting at my building. This is, my mother still lives there, so I visit as much as I can. So growing up, this was the view I got, you know. Living in the projects was like a blessing and also like problematic sometimes. Yes, like every weekend the elevator's full of piss. And there's dog shit everywhere, and it smells like weed all the time. But I have this awesome view of, I guess, this power plant in Brooklyn. And as you can see, Brooklyn is already developing. At that point, when I was living there, that was not there. So this image is not mine. This is found on Google. So this is a typical sweatshop that you'll find. Like my mom is from Hong Kong, and my dad is from South China. Toisan is the name of the area. So they met here, and typical typical Chinese immigrant job would be like a garment factory, or AKA sweatshop on Mott Street. My dad was like a typical job, just like a chef, a cook. A chef sounds fancy, but cook is more like it. So yeah, and this is the bus route I took from 14th Street all the way down to PS 126. This is on Catherine Street, not that far from here. And ironically, it's called Jacob Riis Public School. So I would take the bus every day to and from, and I would go down Avenue B, past Tompkins Square, all the way down to Chinatown and back every day. So a little bit about the area at that time, you know, also known as Alphabet City. When you live in Avenue A, B, or C, or D, that's called Alphabet City. And it spans from 14th Street and A all the way to Houston and D, right? So it's like a little grid. And it was full of artists, but also full of working class people working hard, but also had its problems with crime, drugs, and all of the above. So this is 1991. This is not my image. This is found on Google. This is Avenue A and East 7th Street, Memorial Day, 1991. There's some problems with the tenants that live there and the police. This is also a found image. 13th Street, probably Avenue B, in 1994. This is entering the time when there's all the squatters in the area, right? And the city is trying to get everybody out so they can build their fancy glass looking buildings. And I saw this every day going to and from my elementary school at the time. And I thought to myself, what the fuck's going on here, right? But at the same time, later on as I got older, I realized that's the blessing that I had living in the projects. You know, project's such a negative term or connotation when people think about that, but I had the privilege to see the change. And living in the projects, you're a little bit more protected because it's a little bit more difficult to knock down, say, government housing as opposed to, say, the walk-up tenements or these walk-up buildings. Mm-hmm. Well, that's just the same picture. But yeah, so I saw that every day, and I thought to myself, you know, Chinatown is also being, you know, gentrified, and all the businesses are being either the rent can't be afforded, like the owners raise the rent, and people are trying to encroach on Lower East Side and eventually Chinatown. So I had this thought that, you know, maybe I should do something about it with my artwork. This is just an earlier shot that I created of Chinatown. And at this time, I did not start my project about the interior spaces. This was just, you know, regular street photography. But growing up, I spent a lot of time when I was 15 years old, all the way until currently, I guess. 15 years old, I was part of a lion dance group just around the corner, 211 Canal Street. It's called the Chinese Freemasons Athletic Club. So they've been around for over 60 years. But I decided that I wanted to get involved with that. So lion dancing is a big part of Chinese culture. It's been around for thousands of years. So I was able to learn a lot about Chinese culture and a whole bunch of other things. And when I started picking up on photography, I decided it would be nice to, I mean, I think it's important to document some of the experiences of this lion dance club. So this is just like a practice shot, as in like they're practicing for some moves. It's like martial arts and acrobatic moves. But at the same time, I also saw myself in them because at this point, I'm already moving up the ranks in that organization from a trial member all the way to, say, like instructor. Eventually, I became the treasurer of the organization, and now I'm just like, now I just hang out and just give advice whenever they want me to come to the meetings. So I saw myself in these younger members, and I just thought I should look inside and document and photograph some of these people. So this is like a typical practice where you just gotta jump, because it's all about like calisthenics and strengthening your legs and everything. This was shot with a medium format camera, it's film. So once again, it's a practice, a bunch of young men, not really sure about what they're doing with their lives, you know, typical Chinese American growing up. And I could relate with them because they had a hard time figuring out whether they should assimilate or not assimilate. Do they belong? Do they not belong? But at the club, they, or we call it the club, was something where they all had a common ground and a common bound where they felt safe to be with each other. So I thought this picture was interesting because clearly someone shot the ball, but it looks like everyone's just standing around looking at it. So going back to this kind of ambiguous, like, what are we doing here? So that was in the span of like 2005, 2008, and then comes the project My Home. So basically I started around 2011 and it's still ongoing. So I started, originally I wanted to get into people's spaces, but then, and photograph their interiors, but no one would let me get into their space because there's a, no, I'm not going to let you get into my home and take pictures. So then I started with friends and family. So they were always, yeah, sure, go ahead. Like, I don't know what's so interesting about my house, but if you want to photograph it, sure. So I title all these pieces by their address, but not their apartment number. So for example, this is 37 Allen Street. It's this belongs to my grandmother's brother apartment. So it's an old walk-up tenement, railroad style apartment. Really small. A lot of times the camera is pushed all the way against the edge of the space to try to capture the wide, well, to capture how dense some of these walk-up apartments are. So this is the toilet of that same room. If you go back, if you look, this red bag, that's where the toilet is. This is just a close-up of it. So I go back and forth taking wide shots and also some close-up shots to kind of get a little bit of the macro and micro, like, you know, to see the bigger picture and also the closer vignettes of like the rooms. And it's interesting here, it's like, this is repurposed calendars that, you know, for lack of, or it's a style of interior design for some of these immigrant families. You know? So I grew up here, I'm quite a large family, and it feels like home. That's why I see a lot of these kind of products. And this is the bathtub. You know, a lot of the old tenement walk-ups are the bathrooms right when you walk in. So this bathtub is once again right here. Right. So this is the interior room. If you keep going further down, you'll see another room that has all this shelves and all these objects. So you can't really make out the details, but there's a lot going on in this room, obviously, right? But the thing that interests me the most is that we as in, you know, the Chinese community, Chinese American, Chinese immigrant community, we have all very similar lifestyles in the sense that we all shop at this store, which is called Duck Churn. It's a meat shop that's been around for a very long time. We all have these canteens because we love hot water. And we love gossip magazines from Hong Kong. This is some herbal tea, probably. And we love our cognac. And these are fortune-telling books, so that you can pick an auspicious date when you either have like a party or getting married. And so on and so forth. And this is the HEPA filter because 9/11 hit, and this is downtown, so everyone had a free filter. This is the butter cookies that we all love to eat and then repurpose for, you know, trinkets and money. And I go on and on. I mean, there's things I find sometimes that I, you know, and this is the really tacky, quote-unquote, fobby bed sheet that we also love to have. And this is just, once again, like going back to the close-up idea, it's always back and forth. You know, this is the, you know, the home attendant sheet that you fill out to make sure, you know, they visit you, because these are senior couples, so they make sure they're still okay. The beads that are probably blessed by a temple. So now this one is 82 Bayard Street. This is on the corner of Bayard and Mott Street. So you can identify the similarities, right? Going back to that bathroom with the bathroom with the calendar girls. These are actually like Hong Kong beauty pageant contestants. And she's the famous actor, actress. So we have this thing where we love to repurpose calendars. So these are like free gifts you get in Chinese community, like you buy something or rent tapes back then. So what they do, they chop off the calendar and then they just repurpose the image as a wallpaper. And you know, there's also all these wonderful places like the Sydney Opera House, and you know, I think this is Salzburg, I think. And so yeah, whenever I go into these spaces, I always find these identifiers that really connect with, you know, my own home. This is like a mooncake box that's been repurposed. The orange is also another thing. Broken down Cheerios box, so it can be used again one day. A little room in that apartment. And this belongs to my cousin, my cousin's grandparents. So it's just a senior couple that no longer lives there anymore. But they had kids, and they've grown up, and they moved on, they married, and they got kids of their own. But there's always these remnants of when they were growing up, these little, you know, cute little stickers were there, and they're still there. They're still there in the house. Well, when I photographed, they were still there. And I thought that was interesting, because it's like a remnant of something that once was, in an innocence. Same, excuse me, different room. Once again, the famous butter cookie box. And the work touches on a lot of things. It's not only Asian or Chinese community. I mean, I have people that come up and say, my mom or my grandma also use, you know, have this type of box, and they also use it for storing whatever it is they want to store in it. So, you know, it crosses many, many lines. This is 10 Catherine slip, which is actually really close to my elementary school back then. You know, just being creative with like taping down this basketball hoop. This is 612 East 14th Street. This actually is the kitchen that the apartment that I grew up in, the kitchen. So you got the foil that you want to make sure you don't dirty with the foil everything. You know, this looks like an innocent plastic container, but you know, you can ask any Chinese person, once they see that, they know you probably got it in Chinatown. These little cubbies for salt, cornstarch, and MSG. And also the repurposed jug for garbage can. And the MJ, and the Mahjong table right here also. So this is also going back and forth, right? Going close up and then also pulling back. This is my grandmother's house in 205 Avenue C. Once again, the red or orange bags that exist in, because if you shop in Chinatown, you're probably getting a red or pink bag. The calendar, the Mahjong table. This is like a little decorative slip that you have like to wish you like good luck. And this is my my cousin's child. So like when I go into the spaces, I see random things that I always take for granted, because I visit, I just see it as, okay, it's just a bunch of hangers. But then it actually, it's just like, it speaks a lot, because it talks about like repurposing and saving everything. And it's like, that has an underlining like effect of how you live and how you know, due to social economics reasons, you just can't throw some things away sometimes, and culturally. So I'm gonna fly by it and go way over. So this is 77 Columbia Street, and this is the alternative wall of that room. This is the same house, but just the living room. Fish, big fish tanks. Alternative shot of the room. Just another room. So this is a scale of some of the works. It's 6 by 9 feet. So they're almost life size. So they're really, and I purposely choose the ones that are really dense, that have a lot of things inside. So when you blow it up and you print to that size, you really get to see some of the things you don't notice if it's just on this size or something smaller. So they're quite large. Pearl River currently has two pieces. There's on display, which is the one with the pigs, and this one with the calendar girls. And this is just an installation shot of University of Tennessee. That's when I had my solo show out there. And I just want to end with some pieces from Walker Evans from the book. Let us now praise famous men. So this is shot in 1936, part of the FSA, Farm Security Administration project. So Walker Evans was commissioned to take pictures of the South during the Depression. So I just thought that there's this similarity that's interesting, where people are decorating their mantles with calendars also. This is titled Negro Barbershop Interior in Atlanta, 1936. Right, so once again, you see the repurposing of things. Kitchen Wall, Alabama, 1936. Alabama, 1936, a little calendar and a mantle. And this is just a kitchen also. And that's it. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Motohiro Takeda. I've been working with my room camera obscura for a while. I think the first one I made was probably 2007 or 2008 when I was in school with mother. And I was in the beginning. I was fascinated about this idea of living inside of the camera when I was a student. I thought it was really crazy and amazing. So I started setting up my room and blocking the window with garbage bags and just put a little tiny hole on the window and just started live there. And then I wasn't making any work. I really liked that sort of being the idea of being in the camera and seeing the world outside. It's kind of still, but it's still moving. It's kind of live, kind of imagery, moving imagery inside of your room, all over your room, upside down. I mean, I think everyone here knows what the camera obscura is, right? Okay. I was starting to be interested in more about this sort of merging of the space, the interior and the exterior, because I was living inside, but I see the world outside in upside down inside of my space. So in a way, that's like kind of combining those two spaces into one. And then, you know, you're inside, and then the image of the outside coming into my room, but your sort of mind goes out. outward, because you see the world outside. So I was very fascinated about it and started to make this picture. I placed photographic paper, chromogenic paper, on the wall, tiling up. So this little square is 20 by 24 sheet paper, and I placed it on the wall. And then during the time of the exposure, I was basically standing in front of the paper, so I get my silhouette as a photogram on the sheet paper. So this is very actually big. It's the size of my wall. And so then in the picture, you get the sense of the room, size of the room, because it basically is the size of the wall. And then you see the world outside, and then me being inside. So that's sort of through one two-dimensional picture, you get like a sense of two different spaces. So I was in my old apartment, started doing kind of exploring the pose. It's kind of becoming more, I mean, it was my self-portrait, but at the same time, there's a lot of kind of performative element in the work. The exposure time was back then quite long, was somewhere between like 4 to 6 hours. So it was quite hard for me to stand still, but I somehow managed to do that. So the sitting one was actually very easy. The standing up one was really hard. And then it started bringing elements from the outside to, you know, bring the inside. So kind of playing more with the idea of outside, inside. Playing with the scale. And then I started to go into my friend's apartment to do other people's portrait in the same method. And I did I made a couple of pictures with my friends in New York. And then, sorry, I have to switch the image. And then my understanding of the camera obscura is sort of shifting during the course of my kind of experiments in the room. So the outside and the inside, this idea, but the outside sort of started to become more to me a representation of the objective reality that exists sort of regardless of my, you know, existence. And then the room is sort of, to my understanding, it becomes, because I use living room, I mean the bedroom, so that represents a lot about me, and sort of to me it kind of representation or metaphor of my sort of subjective reality or of my sort of inner space. And then the pinhole that pinhole or opening in, on the window is the bridge that connects two different sort of reality in a way together. And so it's like a kind of passage or bridge. And so that in my mind, I discovered the sun in my room. This is new apartment, that's different from the other work. I moved into this apartment and started making my self-portrait. And then after I finished my self-portrait, the room, you know, I opened up the lights, but the room was still covered. And there's like one tiny hole on the window. Then I started seeing this white dot on the white dot on the wall. And then I was like wondering, what's this white dot? And then I realized that was the sort of project picture of the sun. The light was on, so I couldn't see it. But once I turned off the light, I could see the sun, bright sun was just there in my room. And then I was very fascinated about it. So I decided to make a picture of the sun in my room. And it was interesting because I my self-portrait was sort of turning myself into a white energy of human life or something. And then like when I found the sun in my room, I thought like I also found a kind of source of the sort of life force. So after I found the sun in my room, I decided to create a series of pictures through this room and the windows and the view from the outside. And the fascinating experience in the camera obscura is I think partly coming from the sort of blending of the seemingly opposite territories. Not just the space, but sort of it blends the personal and the border between personal and public, also kind of obstruction and the representational, imagination and the realities. So all these things become blurry in the camera obscura. So it was for me kind of natural to use different type of photography, photographic method to create this work. So there's black and white with the camera, also I place papers, black and white papers on the wall. So these are unique. And use long exposures. So starting to kind of following the suns is kind of, it's like following the season outside. I realize a whole lot more about the changing the life outside and the passage of light changes, you know, as the sun moves over the sky, the nature changes, and then the sort of this cycle of season is became very important in my work. And since I'm making my work in the room, my private, very, you know, like personal room, I think my work was very influenced by my personal life too. Like, for example, my wife got pregnant, so that's sort of my work kind of influenced and kind of reflect my personal life as well as the what's going on outside of the world, outside of the window. Basically. So that was the sort of main body of work I wanted to present here today, but I just want to quickly show the kind of new works that I've been working on. So my interest in camera obscura sort of moved on to more about sort of camera obscura as a representation of perception, human perception, because it's really like your eye. You know, the world comes into you through the pinhole, and then this black room is like your mind that sort of, you know, process the information through the eyes, coming through the eyes, and then sort of it kind of becomes you. So I started this work after I finished another sun series. Again, still there's a sun moving through, but still working on this one.
So, I think what was really interesting is the way that you guys are all dealing with almost like shifts in our perception of how we think about home. And whether it's like this sort of lyrical, almost poetic way that you're making work, Moto, or it's just like, you know, I feel like Jesse's taking like a very sort of cold, bureaucratic form of identity, and you know, by you're like transforming it into these like very beautiful nature scenes that are almost like, you know, in the way that you present them on the human scale, it's something that's very sort of tangible. Or with you, Lewis, it's like very, it's a very concrete way of looking at home. But then I've seen some of Lewis's, I saw the ones that are in Pearl River Mart, and then I saw another picture last year, and they're so like gigantic that you almost feel that the all those pink pigs are gonna fall on you. Or like all of the stuff on the shelves, you know, like the scale is so massive that it shifts our idea of like what home is. So I really love how you guys are doing that. And I don't know, maybe Lewis, you could sort of talk a little bit about why you chose to make the images so big and...
Yeah, so there's a backstory to that. Like in, when I started in, got my BFA at Hunter and my MFA at Hunter. There was this painter professor that always said, photography is so limiting, you know, like, you guys are always bound by a certain size of the pre-cut paper and everything. So he was like always saying, can you go a little bigger? Like, I'm just curious of how this would look if it was a little bigger, you know. And it kind of made me realize that, you know, at that moment when he said that, I've only, you know, printed 11 by 14 or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I just kept going bigger and bigger, and finally I got up to this size, like, which is like 6 by 9 feet, and that was kind of my breaking point. I personally cannot go any bigger. This is, I think the work is good at this size. Because some of the work that I've printed, I'd say 24 by 36, for example, they were great, but once I started experimenting with it even larger and larger and larger, when I hit that size, it felt right. Mm-hmm. And it's also, and a little bit is also like, I want to be unapologetic about it. I just want to like hit you with a big print of the space. You know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's how
it is. Well, it's like when you go into someone's home, especially in New York, you're going into a really tiny space. And so it's almost like you're exploding that.
Yeah, like all of the spaces I photographed, they're all really small, quote unquote small. Cause, yeah, and it's like a very New York thing. It's also a very downtown thing where space is limited, mm-hmm. and when you have less space, you have, you know, it's full of density of all the objects and possessions, mm-hmm. and that was another way to just, if you, with that size, you're able to actually see certain things that you wouldn't have picked up if you, say, looked at it at a smaller size. So it, I want that immersive experience, mm-hmm. where you feel like you're kind of in the space.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Moto, yours are huge too, right?
Yeah, I mean, some of them.
Like the first ones that you showed are like how big, would they be like the size of this wall?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, some of them are like